So our roundtable is dedicated to medical diagnostics, accurate, timely diagnostics. Let me invite everyone to the discussion and address the meaning of medical diagnosis in the chain of medical services. Once we talk about the achievements in the Russian healthcare, we should certainly note such a relevant event as regular regular health tests and visits. And I would like to take 2 or 3 minutes of your time to have a general discussion and outline some areas of interest, and then move to specific speeches where we can talk about technologies of diagnostics or some other solutions that might be useful to the healthcare. Let me hand over to academician of the Russian Academy of Science, Evgeny Shikhto, who will talk about the translation medicine. Thank you, Igor Lvovich. Dear friends, let me thank the steering committee for the invitation to take part in this roundtable dedicated to the new approaches to diagnostics and treatment in medicine, in healthcare. The current situation in healthcare faces booming biomedicine to include personalized medicine, development of IT technologies, huge research in molecular medicine, cell medicine. But these huge achievements in fundamental research have not brought to significant changes in clinical practice. So this is considered as a crisis, difficulties of translation of everything new that discovered into the clinical practice, translation into education, human resources. So diagnostics and treatment. I'm an expert in molecular and cardiovascular diseases. How to transmission the new knowledge into life? Everyone is saying that we need to change the paradigm, the approach to research, to treatment of patients. This paradigm must be based on the latest achievements of science. This is what you call the so-called translation medicine and personalized medicine, and includes information technologies. So we're all thinking how to overcome this barrier. What problems do we have in diagnostics of cardiovascular diseases? So we see the gap between science and practice, science and treatment. And this gap shows that we have not made strong progress in medical therapy, in medication therapy. We have almost exhausted new ways of treating cardiovascular diseases and cardiovascular surgery. Unfortunately, although we have optimistic research in cell therapy, we haven't had many implementation in practice. So many new things that have been researched have not been translated into real life, into actual treatment. So we are now talking about the so-called translation medicine that should help us deliver the new knowledge to the healthcare. So we'd like to consolidate the efforts of researchers and doctors to engage the pharmaceutical companies, project managers, and also engage information technologies and digital technologies. So we're looking to apply everything new. We are looking to see how new medications are created with less funding and less effort. BM marker search, microRNK, iPS cells, all this should serve the health of our patients. New medications, new drugs, optimers. So these are the most relevant subjects of today, relevant factors of today that define innovative development of healthcare. Thank you, Evgeny Vladimirovich. Thank you for your concise description. Let me now hand over to Igor Kotkovo, Director of Moscow Clinical and Science Department of the Minister of Healthcare of Moscow. Dear Igor Lvovich, dear organizers, let me also thank you for the invitation to this wonderful forum. Thank you for this opportunity to speak here. So to extend the words of Evgeny Vladimirovich, let me talk about the translation of our knowledge to patients. This translation from science to practice is critical in terms of improving results of treatment. So we have accumulated a lot of knowledge and we would like to transmit it to our patients. Early diagnostics is critical. We deal with oncological diseases a lot. In one of the presidents of the European Surgery Societies, one of those representatives said, all the recent developments in oncology are based on life extension and early diagnosis. Chemical therapy, radiation therapy, surgery, abdominal surgery has reached their limits. Anesthesiology help us do all kinds of things in surgery, but we have come to limits. What we can do, we can improve the quality of life, life extension, extend the lifespan. This is where we can develop better. unfortunately, now 60 to 70% of the patients we get people in the third stage of cancer. This is unacceptable. And in such countries as Korea, for instance, 80 to 90% of patients are diagnosed with cancer when they are on the only on the first stage of this disease. So there is a lot to do in this country to improve early diagnostics, because this is a way to save people's lives. So we do have a lot of medical devices available for diagnostics, a lot of tests, but what we need is to bring people to hospitals to just to track their health on their own and to be diagnosed early. When we were preparing for this session, we were talking about how to make patients understand the importance of prevention. And there is a lot to do here. We have a lot of foreign colleagues in the Russian Federation, just for their sake, I'll say. In the Russian Federation in 2013, we launched a program for screening or regular screening or checkup. This is free for all Russian citizens. So each year, 21 to 23% of the population must be screened. And with the coming few years, we would like to cover 100% of the population with these annual checkups. We know that there are four clusters of diseases: cardiovascular, oncology, pulmonological diseases, and diabetes. Four big groups of diseases. What we're lacking is information. We need to inform our patients, and we need to inform doctors. So later during our session, I would like to talk about that more. Just to keep that in mind when you do your speeches, to speak about the importance of informatization of patients and doctors. Is there anything you want to share with us? I know that you must leave early. Is there anything that you would like to share now? We're a new organization, a new entity, clinical scientific center based on the Gastroenterological Research Center. Moscow is now concentrating its intellectual resources in various research centers. So we have a multi-function research center, but one of our priorities is those checkups, regular checkups. So all patients that come to us for diagnosis, so we try to perform those checkups, and also we try to inform all the patients, to give them information that is critical for maintenance of their health. So we try to provide information about various types of diseases to patients, and we try to engage as many patients in those checkups as possible. So we try to do it within one day. So a patient comes and he gets all the tests and research in one day. So and we are trying to build trust in patients, credibility. Have you identified any statistics so far? It's too early to speak about statistics. We started doing this since April this year. Let me now hand over to our Western colleagues. And I think we only use names and surnames. Let me now invite Joseph Semi. Maybe you'll talk about the new technologies that you like incorporate, or maybe challenges you face. Dear colleagues, thank you for this opportunity to speak. I try to stay away from the mic, not to create that horrible noise. Ophthalmology is one of the golden professions where you can see everything. When telemedicine was created, was developed, everyone thought that telemedicine was needed for those areas of medicine where you could see everything, where you could picture things. And this was fully justified. Introduction of global screening programs in Great Britain, Canada, and Australia demonstrated that within 10 years they were able to cut blindness from diabetes by 10%. This is impressive because we are talking about the disease that basically hits 10 to 12% of the population. So many people get vision problems and irreversible blindness from diabetes. Blindness from diabetes is number one issue today in ophthalmology. And it can be resolved through screening, and our Western colleagues have demonstrated this successfully. The second area of development is early diagnostics, for sure, because our surgery of the central zone of retina guarantees 90% of the vision precision. So the earlier we diagnose, the better vision we can provide, and the better the rehabilitation period. So Once we talk about early diagnosis, is also we talk about costs. The main purpose of healthcare is to maintain an operable healthcare system and expert healthcare workers. So the approaches we implement help us reduce cost and maintain human resources. Human resources is an issue in any country. So we are doing this through new approaches.
У нас сегодня, кроме представителей системы здравоохранения, присутствуют представители различных компаний, производящих решения различные в здравоохранении. Я хотел бы предоставить слово начать наш с господин.
I would like to give floor to Takao Kubaniva, who represents Hitachi company, the healthcare department of Hitachi company. Could you please share the new technologies that you currently implement?
Introducing me, and we are very glad to have a chance to talk. And please look at the TV. I'm talking about the particle therapy. This is for the cancer treatment. Next, please. Next. So maybe you know that the cancer treatment is three methods: surgery, chemotherapy, or radiation therapy. But both three technology has a good point and bad point. And especially for the radiation therapy, at this moment, damage is high. So we are now developing the particle therapy. And using this technology, quality life of the patient will be improved. And this technology is based on physics. Usually the radiation therapy using the X-ray damage not only the tumor, but also the normal tissue. But using the particle, cancer only irradiated and the normal tissue, a critical organ, is survived. That means before treatment, they do not do the surgery, this technology can save. And also after treatment, chemotherapy or something, normal tissue are not damaged. So this is good for the after treatment. But to realize this technology, imaging technology or information technology is very important. Physics, to realize real treatment, need to be the imaging or other method be developed. So this map shows the facilities now working or under construction. As you can see, that Japan, US or Europe is now using, but unfortunately Russia, there are little. So this time, we would like to introduce this technology to Russia also. And I'd like to explain a little bit about the progress or case study, how we improved. This facility is mostly 2000 opened. And the basic figures of the machine is same. Okay, this is the latest machine now treat the patient in US, MD Anderson. The basic method or treatment physics is the same, but we improved the imaging devices or other control system. And this machine improved, damage for the treatment is more improved. And there are two methods. This is a little bit technical issue, so I'd like to skip. But anyway, usually use some irradiation technique based on old technology. But we improved based on imaging or information technology or other method to apply, and very good machine we developed. And this machine is also the availability, like realization for the machine itself is improved. And now we, Japan, set up latest facilities in Japan. And we spend mostly 15 years to improve using the advancement of the imaging or information technology. So we finalized very nice features, facilities. So basic physics to treat the patient particle is same, but the technology was improved for the imaging or other technology, and features are very nice and the compact system we are realized in Japan. And now such a technology applied to the US very advanced facility like a Mayo Clinic or St. Children Hospital. And also based on such an improvement, now Moscow, we are planning to set up a new proton facility with European medical centers. And this technology will expand to the world around the world. And this is one feature of the facility in Moscow. So anyway, what I would like to say is that physics, that treatment method is same, but advancement of the imaging or information technology or other things merged and improved. And now system is completed, so I would like to introduce this system to the Russia. That's all. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Am I correct that at the current moment you localize it on the on the basis of European Medical Center in Moscow? This is the private clinic. This solution.
Same, mm-hmm. But equipment base, like a magnet or a measurement, some parts.
I was asking about are you. Based on the center, the EMC center here in Moscow. So it will be a solution with a private medical company, right?
Yes, right. Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. Do you have some statistics on inventing such already running system in the United States? Probably interesting facts and figures about how your systems were improving healthcare issues in specific areas of United States or Japan?
This method is applied during 20 years or so on, and survival rate or something comparing with photon treatment with proton rare case, like a timing is short, but the survival rate or doing the chemotherapy and life become longer, there are many data now. But now we are accumulating.
So you're in the process of accumulating. I am asking because we here in Russian Federation are intensively developing a plan of inventing such centers. Mm. And there are private companies and as well as the state is also the Ministry of Healthcare is developing its own plan, so we will be very interested in having some information about issues, how these technologies can improve.
Okay, so let me explain one example. Mm-hmm. MD Anderson in Houston, very famous cancer center, they are doing the chemotherapy after the treatment. Actually, using the photon treatment, normal tissue be damaged, so chemo dose be restricted. But using the proton, chemo dose can increase. That means the survival rate, theoretically, extend. So such a case, there are many. So maybe we will give some report by the doctors later.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kubaneva.
I would like to give the floor to Mr. Butenko, Alexey Butenko. Would you like to tell us about your company, and maybe it will be better to tell about the new technology which your company implies in the Russian Federation? So, can I give your presentation just now or later? If you will give us a short description of your technology and the framework of your presentation, it will be very good.
what develop the early screening and diagnostics. Thank you very much for the opportunity to give my presentation. As was said many times, that we are on the brink of changing the paradigm in clinical oncology, because up until now, all of us have used empiric approach in treatment with very scarce information about the dissemination of a cancer, about the staging of tumor, and about individual characteristics, both tumor and individual conditions of a patient. And as this, I would like to cite the phrase by very famous dramaturg, by Schmidt, there is nothing the same. And perceiving in you, you will not get, you will not tied by just be boring. And in relation of oncology, now we have anatomical diagnostics, different methods of anatomical diagnostics to detect some tumor. Without understanding about functional activity of this lesion, and in this situation, hybrid technology will help us. So, electron positron tomography with the CT combining, it will be just good in this. And on this scheme, you can see mechanisms and pathways of cancerogenesis. This information is well known by us oncologists researchers, but I think that there are a lot which we don't know just now. And uniting methods of hybrid technology and microbiology methods, like individual characteristics of tumor, we can transfer, we can go to a new approach in target treatment. Speaking about target treatment, first of all, we have a cessation of target drugs. These are very expensive methods of monoclonal antibodies, and as you can see on this scheme, allowed for usage monoclonal antibodies as target drugs, and you can see here drugs of the second and third phase of clinical studies, which will be implemented into clinical practice. And this list will be added. All our anti-cancer treatment, not chemotherapy, but also surgery, especially when we are speaking about target surgery, it should be applied. This term should be applied when we would like to make organ conserving surgery in the early stages of tumor, because aggressiveness of tumor is behind what we visualize. Despite the first stages of cancer, the aggressiveness is can be very high, and we need to go through. And we should expand the scale of the operation. And we also need to take into account big, major operations when we damage the quality of life of our patients after operation, post-operatively. And simultaneously, we don't know the expectancy of life for this type of patients. We must perform such type of operations, major operations, damaging operations, only in patients with proposed long period of life. So PET CT planning, we need to radiate biological active zone, and sometimes it's not correlated, it's not coincide with mass volume. which be measured on the basis of standard tests. And with this personalized approach, we improve the quality of life of our patient. So avoiding unnecessary courses of chemotherapy, to decreasing the dose of radiotherapy, decreasing the rate of pneumonitis and complications from radiotherapy, even not taking into account the economic expenses. I will give you some examples. The control of effectiveness, PET-CT for control of the treatment, when after two courses of treatment we can see the decreasing of activity for tumor, which improved. This factor proves the correct, that we chose correct treatment. And chemotherapy, and this picture you can see that chemotherapy in this case is a predictor on effectiveness of treatment, and we need to change the scheme and we need to change the method of treatment. And now you can see from the point of view of consumer, and to address fundamental organization in fundamental resources, because we need a very fast diagnostic. You understand that in oncology we need to make diagnosis very fast, and sometimes even life of our patient depends on it. We need to use microchips in cancer diagnostics. This picture shows us that any anti-cancer drug will decrease the activity with time pass. This is because of their resistance. Cancer cells just adapt to drug, and we need to develop multi-targeted drug. And I think this is one of the prospective direction for development. And oncotheranostics. So in one drug, we can combine diagnostic drug and treatment agent. Which kind of treatment agent we need to discuss separately? I just would like to say that these three directions of development need the further development. And I think that future will be depend on them. What is the horizons of implementing these technologies in Russia? PET-CT diagnostics, I would like to tell about that because it's the closest subject issue for me. You understand that demand for this type of technology is very high. We have not more than 30 PET-CT centers in the Russian Federation in general, but in accordance with European standards, we need 150 PET-CT scans, and our company, in the framework of a private-state partnership, we do design and implementation of such centers to the stage turnkey. It takes from the very start to the stage of turnkey around about 100 and half a year. And for instance, in Kazan city, we already launched such type of center, and now we are in the process of opening just branch of clinics, and the central part of Russia will be covered with such type of services, and it will allow our patients not to go to big cities, for instance, to Moscow and St. Petersburg, for such type of diagnostics and treatment. And it will be just a great help for all of us. Together with the solutions which allow us to have medical manipulations, both in diagnostics and in treatment, they have other informational technology which help you to organize different processes, including diagnostics processes. And I would like to ask who represents who solutions to tell us which solutions they have and how it's implemented in the system of healthcare.
My name is Wolfgang Hildesheim. I'm from IBM, and I want to present you one of the major solutions of IBM called Watson and its relevance for the healthcare space. This is the most significant single investment of IBM this year, more than $1 billion. So I think the video started here. Maybe first we are watching the video. Can you hear it? What do we have to do? Now it's coming. So I show you a video on a solution, Watson solution, called Oncology Advisor, which is actually supporting doctors in hospitals to take the right decision on cancer therapy, diagnosis, and treatment. And it is used to enable patients as well on their treatment and care. And I hope you will be able to listen to it. So while it is starting, I present you shortly what the Watson technology is about. The amount of data on the planet is growing year by year, and 80% of all data is actually unstructured data, text, like doctor letters, like publications, like research, and nobody in the space is able to read this. And the Watson technology is now a technology being able to read, think, and decide. And this system is now based on Watson technology. And maybe you can turn up the volume.
He's preparing to see a patient. He logs into the electronic medical record. And instead of spending time trying to find relevant information, he uses the IBM Watson Oncology Diagnosis and Treatment Advisor. He pushes the Ask Watson button and Watson analyzes the patient data against tens of thousands of documents from its vast body of medical literature. Dr. Norton starts with a case information tab where Watson has pulled out the relevant information, as well as suggestions for additional information to gather. Moving to the test options tab, he sees tests that Watson suggests that he consider ordering. He presses the evidence button to see the reasons why Watson suggested the first test. Then he drills down further into a specific reference that supports the suggestion. Once the results of the tests come in, Dr. Norton presses the Treatment Options tab to see a panel of suggested confidence scored treatments. He also sees a list of clinical trials to consider. Again, he reviews the supporting documentation by pushing the Evidence button. Dr. Norton has new information to add to the case, so he pushes the blue Watson avatar on the bottom and speaks directly into the microphone. He makes sure that his words have been transcribed correctly and submits the new information. Watson returns a revised set of confidence-scored treatment suggestions that take the new information into account. It also updates the list of clinical trials to consider. Shifting gears from Dr. Gordon's role to that of a hospital or health plan administrator, the advisor provides a customizable dashboard showing key performance indicators like where the advisor is being used, how it's performing, and what information sources are most useful.
The administrator can drill down into the data more specifically to get more details, such as performance over different time spans, metrics on specific types of cancer, or in this case, a narrower geographic area. This is just one of the many areas that Watson's cognitive capabilities can be applied to help people live and work in better ways.
So what you saw here is a system called Oncology Advisor, which is used right now as today in the MD Anderson Cancer Center, Takao talked about earlier. And this hospital has the strategy to be the leading hospital on the planet for breast cancer. So that's why they actually are reading all publications in the internet and all databases on breast cancer. And they are working it, improving it on a day-by-day basis with this system called Watson. And so they improve the quality of diagnostics and treatment. And actually, they are in competition with another hospital called Sloan Kettering, and they now have their own oncology advisor, as you see, so that is very accepted by the market. Other leading companies are now building on the same technology, nephrology advisors. So this is the part where Watson technology from IBM supports expert systems for doctors. The other side are systems where you enable the patient and you distribute information about treatment, care, and diagnosis across large countries like Russia. For instance, Norway is a country where you have difficulties to come in the different valleys and fjords. So they build up a national system to distribute medical knowledge across all citizens. And you can see in the internet a page on Norwegian healthcare system where you really have the semantic technologies where you find things that are, the value of Watson technology is that you find information faster, you get a higher quality of results, you learn instead of searching, you learn instead of searching, so you have a search in search. So for instance, you search for dust allergy, and then you see immediately a result what it can be related to. And this kind of network capability is built into the systems. So this would be, for instance, what you talked about, Igor, about the 23% of screened population. So imagine that you have a central system and you can centrally read all the reports of all the doctor letters of all these screened documents and apply a system like Watson to it. You would immediately have a tremendous value coming out of it in terms of diagnosis, understanding, planning, and care. So this is a value, a more intelligent support system applied to doctors and patients called Watson. Thank you.
Wolfgang, я хотел бы задать вопрос, есть ли опыт у вашей, есть ли у...
Has IBM ever implemented such solutions at the level of government healthcare in some countries? In countries that have centralized healthcare procurements, or maybe at the level of a province or a big region of a country or nationwide? So, and what is this experience, if I may ask?
For instance, I'm from Germany, and Germany, you have a legally obliged system that everybody needs to be health insured. So the big health insurers actually are analyzing their records in terms of diagnosis, coding, is this correct or not? So there are different use cases for cost saving, for optimization, for call centers and service centers to really help the patients. So you should think about all areas in your system where you have a large amount of electronic text. And nobody would be able to read this, like all publications on research for a drug, or all publications on certain medical topic, or all treatment records in insurance or in your ministry. Yeah, then you apply this semantic technology to it, and you will get out a lot of value.
Хорошо. Vielen Dank, Wolfgang. Спасибо вам большое.
Thank you very much for your contribution. And now I would like to hand over to Josef Semi. Could you please share your experience in developing technologies that help better screening and early diagnostics and further therapy?
For this opportunity. I would like to talk about an area which is very important globally and not particularly for Russia, is which is sepsis. So maybe I should have the remote, please. So as you know, sepsis has got a very high healthcare burden around the world, irrespective of where you are. There are over 8 million patients diagnosed with sepsis per day. Severe sepsis accounts for about 40% of all ICU expenditures, roughly about $16.7 billion in the United States only. So the average cost per patient is about $20,000, which is much higher than any other patient in the hospital. We might not be aware of it, but people die from sepsis much more than acute myocardial infarction, than stroke, or even pneumonia. So the number of deaths is really high in the world, and the reason for that is we don't have a proper diagnosis. As you can see, the hospital beds, the median duration for a patient in ICU is much higher than a normal hospital bed. So there is a problem in sepsis in diagnosis as well. Usually it's just very vague. It's difficult to diagnose, especially in early sepsis. So if patient arrives to the emergency room and you look at him and he's got tachycardia or he's got a little bit of fever, you don't really know what you're dealing with. Specifically patients that are very young and they, after surgery, have some inflammatory response. So it's very difficult to diagnose sepsis. So in many cases, sepsis is all delayed in diagnosis or basically missed. Those patients that have pneumonia, for example, are young, ended up in ICU, and sometimes die without actually a diagnosis, just of pneumonia, but without knowing the cause of that. So the problem with diagnosis, with sepsis, is that for every hour that we delay treatment, the survival decreases by 8%. So if you think about a patient that arrived to emergency room and he hasn't got the right treatment, after 6 hours, basically he's got 50% chance of dying. So if we don't diagnose early, and I heard earlier how important it is to diagnose early, not only sepsis, but particularly now when I'm talking about sepsis, is really increasing patient survival rates. So what we're dealing today, a technology, is a technology that is 150 years old. We're doing blood culture. Now, blood culture is very slow turnaround time. You can get results only after 48 hours. Failure to detect fetitious pathogens. For example, if you have a fungus in your blood, blood culture will not show it. 50% or more of blood culture are negatives. And if you give antibiotics, blood culture will be negative. So at the end of the day, we're dealing with something that is absolutely suboptimal. And doctors today, in terms of sepsis, are shooting in the dark because they don't know what they're treating. So they give a very broad empiric therapy without knowing what is the pathogen that they are dealing with. So we have developed a technology called Eridica platform, which is identifying hundreds of bacteria, candida, fungi, and all viruses. It's a comprehensive array of bacteriology, and the results comes within 8 hours. And it's going to be CE marked in Europe in middle of November. Now, I'll explain a little bit about the technology. I don't want to get into details, but it's based on PCR and mass spectrometry. So you can see we extract DNA, we extract blood, DNA, we amplify it, we do a mass spectrometry, and then we have a very large database which we, in the mass spectrometry, identify this particular bacteria. So all you need is a 5 milliliters of blood, not more. All the systems today in the world require blood culture first and then detect, like, for example, Multitoff or any other. But this is the only system in the world that if you take 5 mL of blood, within 8 hours, you will know what grows in the blood, if it's virus, bacteria, or a fungi. So we have done a phenomenal study in Europe, which is a multi-center, and we wanted to compare the results with this technology with a standard microbiology testing, which is blood culture. And then we wanted to see if it applies to changes in prescription of doctors. Doctors are going to change their treatment based on these results. So those are all the centers. The trial is called Radical. It's been UK, France, Switzerland, UK, Belgium, Germany, and Austria. And we did all this trial with over 540 patients. But I want to allude you to one area here, and I don't want to go into too much details, but the negative predicted value of this test is 97%. In other words, if we don't detect anything in the blood, there is nothing there. So many patients will not need even treatment. And in many cases, 169 cases, PCR was positive and the culture was negative, which shows you what is the real life. The real life is that blood culture most likely doesn't go negative. The patient is sick in front of the doctors, but it doesn't give him any results. So so we detected very accurately all the pathogens. More samples were positive compared to cultures, 200 versus 67. Interesting enough, how do we know that what he detected is the correct? What we did is that we took blood from the same patient from different sites, from the left arm, right arm, from the neck, and we consistently show that all those tests shows the same bug all the time. But the blood culture showed us every time a different thing. Or it was a contamination, or it was negative, but this particular one shows us every time the same bug. So when we show all these results to an independent practitioners, they in 43% would have changed the treatment for that patient for sepsis. So in other words, in 43% of cases, the treatment for sepsis was basically wrong, or too long, or too wide, or too narrow, or wrong overall. So and it's basically correlate with the literature that we know that early treatment of sepsis in 50% of cases is not really correct. So it's early treatment, it's directly from blood, and what we also can help is antibiotic stewardship. If you can narrow and target therapy in antibiotics today, you can reduce antibiotic resistance for the future. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't want to scare you here, but in 20 years' time, we won't have... Within 20 years, we won't have any new antibiotics. There is no development of antibiotics anywhere in the world today. So if we have resistance for what we have today, we will not be able to treat sepsis anymore. So this is going to be important. And the last thing I want to show is that we today in sepsis, in exactly where we're in cancer 10 years ago. 10 years ago, we were giving therapy, cancer for everyone the same. So it was not targeted therapy. So because we have developed diagnosis of DNA, we sequenced the DNA, we could do that. Today we could do it in sepsis. We can target therapy exactly to what the bug we find in the blood and save lives. And cost, obviously. Thank you.
Большое вам спасибо, господин Сэмми, за очень интересный и содержательный доклад. Я хотел бы предоставить слово Александру Полетаеву, чтобы он рассказал о тех...
Let me hand over to Alexander Polytaev, and he will talk about the solution his center is offering. Yes, I would like to have my presentation on the screen. Thank you for this chance to speak up. At such sessions, it is better not to talk about achievements, but to criticize what is worth being criticized. Let us have a look at this small picture. Ancient Greece. No medicine in the modern sense of the word. There are no tablets. There is no pharmaceutical industry. And people live an average of 30%. The average life expectancy is 30%. But surprisingly enough, in Sparta, you could elect people to become a senator only if the person is older than 60. The same for Athens. How come? Statistics is not lying. It's a bit tricky. If we remember that out of five newborns, only two to three infants could live up to 5 years. If they were able to live longer than 5 years, then they live really longer lives. Hippocrates lived 90 years ago, and many famous ancient Greeks lived long lives, like 80 to 90 years. So we can only praise the pediatrics because we were able to fight infant mortality successfully. But how long did ancient Greeks live? And they live the same lives today. What is obvious is that modern medicine of repair, modern medicine of Lancet, and modern medicine of tablets, of pills, cannot help us live through the biological limit of 120 to 140 years. Maybe we need to change the paradigm. So we should be looking not for medicine of repair, but for medicine of prevention. Therefore, we need a mirror to look into our human body and to see a disease when it is not present at the clinical level, it is not visible at PET, MRI, etc. And we do have this mirror. It's our immune system. The immune system can signal molecular changes that initiate in early stages. Genetics can show potential risks of something that may happen or may not happen. The immune system demonstrates of what is happening years and months before the illness, because our immune system is our main cleaner. And macrophages and antibodies are its main tools. We have more substances for utilization, like microbes, or do we have something else that actively dying cells, for instance, with which the immune system must fight, and then we'll have more antibodies. Have quarter century ago, after the Chernobyl explosion, some express tests were developed that helped, judging by the antibodies, identify early pathologies just before no symptoms arrive. Early diagnosed, effectively treated. We know this. Or there are tests that, through some software, calculate and visualize the probabilities of illness, and the doctor should only decide which additional tests should be prescribed and what additional measures should be taken. A small example. If you look at the left-hand graph, so the simple tests demonstrate nothing. Nothing happens. In February, something shown up in the kidney. But nothing visualizes yet. That the mid graph, 6 months ago, the tumor began visible on that kidney, began to be visible on that kidney. The biopsy was done. Yes, that was a light cancer, light cell cancer. Well, they performed sectorial surgery and was able to, and the patient was able to avoid a serious disease and would probably live a long and happy life. So if we start doing molecular screening, in other words, we'll screen people at the time when there is basically no illness showing, and when any illness is reversible. And when we start repairing problems early, then we could live longer than in ancient Greece. Thank you. That would be my conclusion. Thank you. Let me now hand over to Mr. Chandru, co-chairman of Strand Life Sciences. You're welcome.
I'm very happy to be here, and I'm grateful that I've been included in this important panel. Could I have the remote, please? Thank you. Yes, one of the advantages of sort of being one of the later speakers is that we can build on a lot of what has been presented. In particular, I'm going to pick up on what Wolfgang just presented of the IBM Watson solution. Dr. Norton was, interacting with the system and actually, sent off for some pathology results. And those pathology results came back and said something about the right treatment and also said something about clinical trials and the appropriate clinical trials. Well, what we've been working on is what goes on to bring those results back. Right, and that again is a problem where information technology plays a very important role. There's again issues of unstructured data and text and interpretations and so on. So really, the driver in all the work that we have done has been this curve, which is now officially called Flatley's Law, right? Flatley is, the CEO of Illumina, and the next generation sequencing technology, as you can see, the straight line there is Moore's Law, which of course has given us the electronics revolution. The cost of sequencing is moving now since about 2007 at the square of Moore's Law. Right, thank you. There was an inflection point, right? So now, will this cost of sequencing DNA and RNA go down all the way to $100? Yes, probably. Less than that, we don't know. It depends on chemistries and advances in technology. But it's clear that something very revolutionary is happening. But the challenge here is really interpretation. Because as you sequence this genome, you're going to find lots of variants. And lots of these variants are variants of uncertain significance. And how you interpret them is the key. And if you want to be, as the session says, fast, accurate, and on time, you better use a lot of technology to get productivity there, right? And that's essentially the focus of what we've been working on, essentially, we're a 15-year-old company that has worked in bioinformatics essentially molecular biology. So let me skip over some of these. We're a spin-off from the Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore. So I'll just leave the slide here. One needed to understand how to analyze, annotate, and look at the molecular signatures from that to be able to actually extract the information and interpret that information. And today, we actually have rolled this entire soup to nuts sort of solution. In India, we work with about 100 hospitals, and this is actually in play. And I'm very happy to say that we have today signed a collaborative agreement with Atlas Biomed Group in Moscow, and we will be bringing some of these solutions to Russia. So what is needed in this interpretation? So you'll get a list of genes, and let's say you're looking at a cancer panel. Typically, you'd look at something like anywhere between, say, 50 to about 200, and now Foundation Medicine is doing 300 genes and so on. So you get a long list of genes. Within each gene, you're going to see many, many variants. All those black lines are variants that have been reported in the literature. The blue lines are the variants that showed up in this particular sample. And now you have to figure out which ones are the drivers of the cancer, which are probably benign, and so forth, right? And so essentially, there's a rank ordering that has to be brought up. Now, the way you do this ranking is based on literature and what is known, right? And to access that, one requires a Watson or something like that. Strand actually built a natural language processing engine back in 2005 to actually read research papers in biology, and we actually leveraged that to build our own internal knowledge bases from which we do these interpretations. I think there's too much detail there to really go over. But let me just, mention a couple of things. So basically, the workflow in doing this kind of personalized medicine based on genomics is, first of all, the genome had to be annotated. And that took us from roughly 2001 to about 2011, right? At least to get the first annotations that were meaningful for health applications. About 10 years of annotation. Now, within the sequencing technologies, there are sequence alignments problems and lots of computational bioinformatics problems. Those have all been solved today, you know. So we have a reference genome, we have the bioinformatics to align sequences. We know how to call out the mutations, the variants that show up. The big challenge that remains is in the interpretation of those variants. Bruce Korf at the University of Alabama, one of the leaders in this field, actually often says we have a $1,000 genome, but we have a $1 million interpretation, right? So it's not quite as bad. It's probably a $1,000 genome and a $5,000 interpretation is where things are today. So how do we, bring that cost of interpretation down? And finally, of course, there's the clinical reporting, there's the, interaction with electronic medical records. And, we saw some very nice solutions with Watson and so on that are already addressing that. So there are many, many pieces, moving parts that have to come together to make this a reality. I'm just going to take the case of cancer and genomics in cancer treatments and elucidate a couple of points. I think one of the challenges that we have faced in working with oncologists in India who are treating cancer patients is that they feel that this kind of sequencing-based analysis is coming to them a little too late, So, you know, they've done the tumor extraction, they've sent it to the lab. By the time they get the report back, it's about 3 weeks, and treatment has to begin, right? And so the window, so I'm sort of alluding to this on-time aspect, right? So the window is that within 1 week, you need to start treatment. And you essentially have to bring together a mix of technologies. I think you can still work with sequencing, but you report very early on certain standard PCR type of results so that treatment can begin. And then within 2 or 3 weeks, you go back with a more complete report, and then there can be a titration of the treatment, there can be a combination of therapies. As Dr. Butenko pointed out, I think quite often you actually want a combination of therapies to treat oncology patients. I mean, quite often we have been able to go back to, for example, in breast cancer cases where Herceptin or tamoxifen have been started and the patient is not responding, we find that there is a PIK3CA mutation which suggests that there's an mTOR inhibitor that would be effective, so we bring in everolimus as a combination therapy along with tamoxifen this kind of observations have also been made at Dana-Farber and the Broad Institute very recently in the New England Journal of Medicine. So I think these the genomic medicine is starting now to really become the standard of care. I also want to bring to everyone's attention not just the issue of oncology.
Не только вопрос онкологии, но также редких заболеваний.
As is well known in pediatric cases, rare diseases can go undiagnosed for many, many years. It can take 4 to 5 years as a diagnostic odyssey for a rare disease to be diagnosed. And about 80% of the documented rare diseases in the world are genetic. And genomics-based diagnosis actually provides an approach where you can get to early diagnosis and perhaps start early treatment with. Now, whether this will actually lead to newborn screening using genomics is sort of a question that society still has to decide on, but there's certainly that option is also opening up. So I think the message is that genomics is certainly going to be one of the drivers of how medicine is practiced in the days to come. I think as the costs sort of become more controlled, we will see that happen. I think, and from genomics, we will move on to other omics. You know, you saw mass spectroscopy playing an important role. And so proteomics, metabolomics, all the omics coming together is the future. Right. Thank you.
Господин Чандру, большое спасибо.
Thank you very much. Taking into account the fact that we have a lot of representatives of different countries, different experts, I would like to thank all of you. It was very interesting to know different approaches, different methods. All of this was very interesting. I would like to ask Mr. Shvekhtov, as a representative of government of states, medicine. We have a Russian system of healthcare. At first, we have a federal ministry, which is the methodological regulator, and every region has its own roadmap, and we have special clusters, regional clusters, which do scientific work, research work, and move our science forward. Our model of healthcare is mostly state healthcare. My question is, which type of this technology and approaches can be interesting in implementing in our country? Thank you, Igor Lvovich, for such interesting question. I'm very glad that our discussion was mostly about translational medicine, personalized medicine, which is based on next generation sequence, molecular visualization from the shape down to not to PET technology, but not about structure and function, but I will down to cell level molecular visualization. These are issues about technology in oncology, in proton therapy. All of this in the line of personalized medicine. But it's not so easy as it seems from the first view. For the last several years, we spoke about genetic personalized medicine, but now we need to speak about epigenetics, that without mass spectrometry, without other technology, which influence on the genome itself. It's difficult to work without that. We know that different diseases are connected not with the disease, but with the environment, and all of these are realized through genomes, and we need to have different. We can have different approaches, but we need to take into account environment, even using PET, CT, and others. B, we'll speak about disease, but we need to speak not about the disease. We need to speak about patient, and it's more sophisticated issue. Practical implementation is a separate field, and we've already discussed this about educational programs for our medical doctors, about our scientists, because they need to understand how to implement it in the correct way. Otherwise, it will be very expensive just to implement in everywhere. And we need to do diagnosis, not in the very early stage. As you rightly said, if we are speaking about prostate cancer, and we need to detect this type of cancer even in the risk group, we need to monitor their predictors, their different parameters to understand, to detect the risk group and to deal with them. 3D printing is also very important. Stomatology. You know that almost all teeth are printed. We can print spines, kidney, and so on and so on. There are big challenges. It's very expensive, of course, but without them, we can move forward. Thank you very much, Evgeny Vladimirovich. We had a separate session about biotechnology. Igor Gennadievich represents the Center of Gastroenterology of the Moscow Department. Maybe you can add something about the continuous educational programs. Maybe you will comment on that topic. Thank you very much. From the regional point of view, I am the last to give a speech. I represent the Moscow Clinical and Practical Center of Gastroenterology, and I am the Chief Gastroenterologist of Moscow. We've spoken a lot about cancer prevention, and I would speak in the line of this and give you some clinical examples. Three positions we discussed: diagnostics, prophylaxis, and treatment. From these three points of view, I will give you the example of three cancers: the stomach cancer, screening, examination, regular examination. This is the key key element to prevent such cancer. We can speak about preventive measures, about Helicobacter pylori, anti-Helicobacter therapy should be implemented in our life in the large scale. And it should be based on evidence-based medicine. And this issue can be resolved. Colorectal cancer, again, diagnostics. If we can regularly perform diagnostics, examinations, so especially in advanced age patients, we cannot speak about preventive measures in colorectal cancer. What can we do in treatment here? What we see in small group of inflammatory diseases in intestines, we can treat them by biological drugs, cytokines. It can prevent such type of cancer, and liver cancer, the third example. All three directions is possible here. That does diagnostic, SBS antigen, we can avoid the main part of liver cancer as a result of hepatitis B or C with the cirrhosis. If we can prevent through vaccines, HBV vaccines, we can solve the issue, resolve the issue. Hepatocarcinoma. And what about treatment? We can treat chronic hepatitis B, and we can resolve the issue also here. So if we are speaking about the last position and how it can be done in the world, all internet resources contain advantages and achievements. Anti-hepatitis C treatment, but I think that everybody knows about new drugs, which costs which is very expensive, and we. But there is a problem to implement this drug into real routine life. So I think that on the example of these three cancer, we can see the structure, how to treat diseases, and how to cope with sometimes difficult situation which we face every time. And what Wolfgang said about advisors, our center also deals with prognostic on the basis of IT technology. We are speaking about prognostic index, which we need to implement in clinical practice. I speak with the gastroenterologist of Moscow, and many of them don't know very simple index, which I used all over the world. Transplantologists use them, but even gastroenterologists don't know them. So we need to educate our doctors on the basis of IT technology to create applications when you can just click on one point and to create an index for this particular patient. About effectiveness of antiviral therapy, a doctor can choose the optimal therapy. So these are our main direction. We try to scale our knowledge during our seminars, during our workshops, and to scale our IT technology using application not for Apple, but for Windows, for instance. This is our reality. And I think that during the next 5 years, we will not recognize our world, not because we implemented genomics or molecular technology. I think that IT technology will go so deep into our life that people who want know how to work with them will be just not in on board. We need to implement them in routine life. There is a question. I have a question. How long have you been implementing this technology into your center? Our center has existed 1.5 years, and we started real work in the March of this year. I think that this is not the last meeting for all of us, and I think that our meeting will be next year also. Just share with your with us your experience about different figures, about mortality, about influence of implication, different IT technology on different parameters. If we take our standard guidelines, our standards, and we put them into our standards, and if a doctor will be able to use them, for instance, on his mobile device, it will provide a high level of survival rate. This is the main object of evidence-based medicine. I will support the idea of IT technology. This is one of the way how to save costs here, to increase the perception for all our people, for understanding all of this process. I will support you. But I would like to expand this idea. Information at first, planning, some implementation, and raising awareness to educate people. Because without that, we won't be able to invest correctly and to have the return from the invested money. And what can you add to this point? I would like to add, not as a representative of ophthalmology, but as a participant of financial market, as a member of financial market. When we are speaking about modern methods of diagnostics, we can tell a lot about them. In ophthalmology, we have another plus. A patient evidently can notice that he starts to see worse. But the main problem in our medical specialty that our patient come to doctor very lately, because if a patient has one eye good and another eye bad, he can notice that he is almost blind when, for instance, a mosquito comes to another eye. We have two other very important players. This is our patient and his employers. It's not in the framework of healthcare system, but it's in the commercial sphere. From our point of view, this is one of the main problems: low awareness and low motivation of employers for implementation of all new technology, and low motivation for our patients. And I think that this is a good reserves we can do something in this sphere also. For instance, we can stimulate, we can do some special incentives for people who keep his health. And we can prevent mortality greatly in through changing the lifestyle. We can diagnose very early, and we can work with all members of our market. Thank you very much for such interesting remark. I will support your point of view. And if it would be conference with journalists, I would be just telling you that it's very important that you withdraw our attention to this issue, because we are working in this sphere. Also, we're trying to form a favorable environment for medium and small scale businesses, and we are working with different associations. We did different studies and with international associations, and we launched portal with corporate employers, and we do a lot for popularization of this knowledge and for implementation of employers in this process.
As to co-funding, this is a very relevant topic, because on the one hand, we need to promote some stimuluses, incentives. At the same time, we need to implement a wider insurance practice, and also engage private funding and funding of individuals. Well, we'll see how it works. I guess the first results will be obtained next year. We're now at the level of internal discussion at the moment, but we are moving in the right way. It seems that we are beyond our agenda. We're 15 minutes late. So if you have any more comments, please, and otherwise we'll wrap up. I would like to make a comment. We need to explain to a patient that if he or she treats herself or himself accordingly, he will live a longer life. And also to the healthcare workers and healthcare managers, we need to explain to them that we need to implement new things. Helicobacter pylori. 80%, well, a high percentage of people have this bacteria, but not 80% of the people with this bacteria develop stomach cancer. Once we're talking about monogene diseases, it's one thing, but if it is if the disease is due to some multi reasons, then it wouldn't be easy to diagnose at early stages. So what I'm driving at is that we should think twice what to spend money on, and not to spend money on things that are useless. Certainly there is no available answer at the moment. There is no available solution at the moment. But what I'm trying to say is that we need to act rationally and not implement all new inventions in medicine, or do implement them, but wisely, smartly. So it is not easy to diagnose a disease on the basis of one gene or one indicator. This is important for the healthcare economics. Hippocratic protectors, billions of rubles are spent annually, but not. This is not done targetedly. So we should identify target audiences for certain treatments or certain diagnoses. So therefore, I call for a reasonable approach to spending that is allocated in healthcare, and maybe distribute this investment differently. Thank you for your participation. I think we've had a wonderful and productive discussion. We've heard about new technologies. We've heard interesting comments. Thank you to every one of you.